So good morning. While I'm setting here up, I work for the Open Knowledge Foundation. So one of the goals we're trying to do is create open data or make open data available. I don't know who of you have experience with open data or worked with open data before, because then otherwise I can keep my intro on open data short. Sorry, too much coffee in the morning. So anybody know what open data is, or should I shortly cover it? So basically what I will cover today is two things in general, and then my favorite cases. If we start with why open data for me, or why I'm enthusiastic about it, it's about gaining back some control about what's going on in public services or with administrative stuff. It's one thing about backdoor deals. We have the TTIP, the trade agreement for, levels where we don't know about anything. And I think it might be a possibility to change the society to a better way. Yep. Just So in general, there are two perspectives on it. One is on the societal level to get more data out of the governments which is produced. And the other one is, which is right now booming, it's a business. Why I'm mentioning business, I don't care so much about business. But basically, that's the leverage of how getting open data there, because every politician wants to have growth and new jobs. One thing right up front, open data is often used for whitewashing. That means even if you have open data, they're covering shit up with that open data, or you have a backlash that it's a question like, what data will be published, who decides how the data is gathered. And we see that case is already there. For the businesses, there's some funny studies out there, in my sense, that claims that $3 trillion per year can be gained through open data. I would call it quite optimistic, that number. In general, there's a historical difference between Europe, mainland, especially Austria, Germany, Scandinavia, and then the Anglo-Saxon sphere. In especially the US, open data comes with a stronger historical background, since it's always used to be that in the US, data financed by taxpayers' money should be accessible to the taxpayer. In Europe, we see the movement right now just starting. It's somewhere started in the middle of the 2000s. Since 2009, it gained traction. It's a long run. It will be a tough battle, and it will take more time since some things are moving slowly. Just want to mention the Transparency Act from Obama. By that, it means by default, every document produced by the US government has to be machine readable. And we know there will be also like an exemptions for like national security and so on, but I think it's a great step forward. And everywhere you have contact with anybody, that should be our basic demand to ask for full open data in machine readable format. And now why I'm getting enthusiastic about it, it's a 4 points. A is on a gatekeeper issue. We can remove the gatekeepers when we have access to the data. That means also we have to understand the data and learn to deal with data. But I think the similarity there was to be with the Bible, when somebody was preaching in Latin for German-speaking people where they don't know what Latin is about, and they said, well, they have the full source on the Bible and their interpretation is the only one. So first of all, we should make sure we have access to it in order to be able to interpret it. The second one is the library. Right now, this is in the beginning. So when the first public libraries came out, people were not able to read. And I think the analogy goes along. We have the data, but we are not able to interpret it or use it, or we don't know what comes out about it. The third one is, if we're using open data worldwide and it's a standard format, let's say for transportation systems, once you make an application for one city, it's possible to easily modify it for another city. So especially for advocacy groups or NGOs, you can make great visualizations or getting data out of it without doing the whole reprogramming or the funny things again. And then the last point is we don't know what comes out of it. So one example from open data or analogy is like the GPS system, which was made available to civic aviation caused by an incident in 84. And out of that now we have GPS running pretty everywhere, like on every smartphone device. So I bring up these issues because there's a lot of hesitations from public administrations trying to prevent open data, and they're coming up with a lot of arguments. And this argument should basically held up against it. And it's the only graphic I have on my presentation, just to make sure that doesn't involve personal data. Because that's the biggest drawback always you hear. It's like, oh, we don't want to have open data because there might be personal data involved. There's, of course, technically a problem to make sure that anonymized data stays anonymized. The more data you have, at one point you can recollect information together. That's for sure true. But I think that shouldn't be the main obstacle of having open data. Quickly, the definition of open data. In the short run, you should be able to use it, freely use it, redistribute it, and also use it for commercial purposes. Why commercial purposes? Because it's one of these barriers. Once they start to get that away, then they have like, we can't open it up because somebody will make money out of the data we produced from taxpayers' money. That's the quick wrap-up. There's three laws. If it doesn't exist, we can't use it. We want to engage with it and it should empower the people. And then for the technical people, I don't know who is in there, more developers or less. I'm not a developer, so I always take my point of view with a grain of salt. That's just like how quality of open data should be. The most important thing is it's out there, it's freely available in a good format. That means also it can be JSON, like on the 3-star points here. And that's in, like, for the future down the road that you have linked open data that's up in the realm. But always make sure it shouldn't be PDF because it's a pain in the ass to pass, and it should be like in a free license. Then there are some projects about open data, what's the current status on it, tracking it. It's open government partnership is one of it, where Germany pretty much sucks. And then there's the census from OKFN Foundation showing which data sets are available, and then there's an open data barometer from the Web Foundation. And now we're coming to the projects. Most of you, I hope, know like bicycle death maps, school ranking, or tax revenue screenings. Some of them will find them already boring because they're out there for a couple of years and nothing changed too much. So I will shortly show this. It's not a real case, open data. I just wanted to point it out because yesterday was the International Refugee Day, and what they did is journalism collective basically have two approaches of showing the migration flows to Europe. The one is like indicating how many people died on the route to Europe. And the latest one released this week was then like how much money is spent on either coming to Europe and either trying to prevent refugees coming from Europe. So it's like the South money, refugees spending going there, and then the North money is like how much the European Union is putting money into making sure that the border is secure for refugees. And it adds up roughly around, it's a conservative calculation, since not of all the numbers out there, it adds up to €2 per person per year on the real borderline issues. And the big stuff you can see here is then deportations bringing back the refugees. You can, all the data is available on GitHub. Also there's like a lot of description about what was the methodology behind it and what data is missing, because getting, for example, the exact number, how many people are deported are not available, the prices are not there, and the travel routes coming to the north, it's based on interviews from the Red Cross and Turkish police, so there's like a heterogeneous data set. That was the first latest, coolest project I think is out there on open data. I really like a lot. You have data visualization in cities. I don't know who is familiar with the Tempelhofer data visualization for Berlin, which was last year. That was based on open data from busy cities. Then there's a nice smaller one is like Air Berlin, Airbnb versus Berlin, showing what is the rent situation and the short-term rent.
You can show that.
Just let's load it up. So this one, like, the for those who are not from Berlin, that was a former airport. The city made a proposal to rebuild some of the area, and this was then like done to show the people who could then at one point vote for the project or not, how it would look like. The company behind it is CityDigWish. I always mix it up with another one, so I have to look it up. CityDigWish. That's exactly what happened. They're doing amazing, this one, great presentations on general what you can do with animations and cities, how many people are living there. And it's all their models are based on open data. And the last part of this cities and open data, Berlin released, I think it's 55,000 buildings in an open 3D model. There's also, for those who are in Berlin currently, a hackathon running with that data set. I think there for sure comes out a great visualization, and if that will be combined with our OpenStreetMap and some other tools, I'm looking forward to that. Fix My Street was a brief, put it up there. It's an old school project. This was most of the popular project. It's basically you can tell your government or your local authorities where something has to be fixed. Then we have in Germany Frag den Staat. It's not real open data, but I always want to point it out because it's important, because with this tool we might get open data more, or we get available information. So you can ask your local authority what was, for example, the reasons why the airport was delayed, or what's the current budget estimation on the airport, and so on. Where does my money go? It's for nice visualization to see where goes your tax money. This is like for UK, you can put in what is your salary. And normally that page comes up, yeah. Then you can see on a daily basis your tax money is spent on defense, almost £1. Culture is only 20 cents. Education is less than defense. Running the government is double as much as defense. And that should give like more information on what's happening. And the more I think those data is available, at least the more discourse or discussion we can have about where we want to change things. That goes then all to the level of having like a participatory budget. And next to where does my money go, there's open spending. That's like then basically for 17 countries where they're having the same approach. Ideally, also in the long run, once the data is standardized, we could more easily figure out what's the cultural spending versus military spending on a per capita, and in which section that goes. Great stuff I want to point out is Sunlight Foundation. They are doing that stuff for the US. They have been monitoring, let's say, the parliaments, the voting, how much money they get, how the legislation is changing, what are the proposals, and making it easy to know. Oh, yeah, that's I have it in there. So I don't think it's that good, but sometimes it's good to know what bullshit they're saying and then making sure it's not getting lost in the history. In UK, you have My Society. That was the one from Fix My Street before. They work for you, write to them. It's like a tool to engage with the politicians. What do they know? And the Right to Know side, it's a Freedom of Information Act. Another one I'm currently working on, it's for extractive industries to make sure how gains licenses, where does the money go in that area. It's important for developing countries. We have the first prototype, which I think is normally really nice. You can here see then you have a list of all the companies involving, and then you can see where do they make money, who they're paying it to, and so on. That brings just some transparency as much as possible into that area for Kazakhstan or Mongolia or India. That's really important to have those tools, because they are dealing with more serious issues in transparency than we are dealing here. Then wrap up, since I'm coming to the end and my 10 minutes over, this attack, hopefully all those points are also next to open data important for you. So it's open source, net neutrality, decentralization, data retention, privacy, IP agreements, and DMA, Open Hardware, and Freedom of Information Act. that's what gets me excited. It's the possibility to maybe have more control about my own stuff, my own data, and influence on what's going on. And that is it. If you have any questions, I have a pad in the beginning. You can easily contact me under this email address or ask me right questions if you have any specific consideration regarding open data. And that was it, and keep on rocking.
We are.